Gators Breakdown, episode 151 is ready to go. I'm your host, David Waters, and you can find me on Twitter at GatorDave_SCC. And joining me tonight, as he does most of the time, is co-host Will Miles. You can find him on Twitter at WillMilesSCC and his website, readandreaction.com. Will, I hope you had a nice 4th of July holiday last week. You know, one of those holidays where it's hot as heck outside, but you like being outside just because that's kind of what that holiday kind of speaks about.
Oh man, definitely. The Wednesday though killed me. I mean, it's like, I don't want to waste a vacation day or two vacation days on either side. And let's just say there might've been a little bit of moonshine that was imbibed on Wednesday night, and I paid for it on Thursday morning, but yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah. I had to work for Channel 4, a TV station here in Jacksonville. We do this big fireworks show, and probably one of the best ones we've done. So, and like you said, it being on a Wednesday didn't really bother me to have to work the 4th. I mean, yeah, I didn't get to spend time with my wife and my kids and all that, but I had yesterday off to make up for it on Monday. So, all was good. I still had a 3-day weekend out of it, but it being on a Wednesday did kind of throw a wrench into everything.
Well, we saw that view you had posted on, I think, Twitter. I mean, that was a pretty impressive place to watch the fireworks, man. So, it looked like a lot of fun.
It was. So, Will, guess what, man? Almost time to really dive into the season coming up. SEC Media Days next week. It'll be my first time going to SEC Media Days. I've been to many Gators Media Days, but this will be a first, and it's cool that it's in Atlanta.
Yeah, man, podcast is taking off. You got all the credentials and all that sort of stuff, and legitimate members of the media now. So
there we go. That won't change a thing.
Well, it's gonna be fun. I mean, we're finally getting to a place where, we can talk about what's gonna happen on the field. We can talk about who the opponents are. We know what the rosters are gonna look like at this point, or at least in some respects, we know what the rosters are gonna look like. And it's just, I at the end of my article this week, I said I just can't wait till September, and nothing could be truer than that.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. Florida and Georgia on the same day in Atlanta. So it's going to be a sight to see. I'm sure many of waves of Bulldog fans will be there the same time as Florida. But Florida takes place, I believe, 1:30 to 5 o'clock on next Tuesday afternoon. So it'll be a fun time. It'll be Dan Mullen, of course, and three players that have yet to be named. So, of course, I'll make sure you follow social media. We'll be sure to tweet that out whenever it is. But it'd be interesting to see who Dan Mullen picks to go there.
Yeah, all I know is I hope he picks people who trash talk Georgia. And maybe does a little bit of that himself. He can galvanize the fan base definitely by picking on the Bulldogs, that's for sure.
Yeah, he's already done it once, so maybe he'll come around and do it again. So remember, you can find all your Gators Breakdown episodes on news4jax.com/GatorsBreakdown. There you will find all the Gators Breakdown episodes, past, present, future, as well as articles from the News 4 Jax sports team. That's news4jax.com/GatorsBreakdown. Lately, I've been putting up my Bill King segments, too, that I do every Tuesday morning on the Bill King Show up in Nashville. So I've been kind of labeling that Gators Breakdown Plus. So anything out of the normal episodes, I'll kind of put that label on it. So you can check it out there, too. But also for the podcast, remember, you can listen on iTunes, Google Play, and YouTube if you want the video version or joining us live as well. When using those services, please share, rate, review the show, let Gator Nation know what they're getting with Gators Breakdown. And on social media, follow Gators Breakdown on Twitter and Facebook at Gators Breakdown. So, Will, of course, news a little slow around Gator Nation right now, except in the world of recruiting, but we'll get to that. But dead period's kind of right now. Like I mentioned, SEC Media Days next week. So we're kind of just reading preseason magazines, getting a glimpse of all kind of lists and stuff out there. But I figured we'd do something different here for our Gator Breakdown listeners so they could get to know us a little better as far as who we are as fans. So I wanted to compile a list of our favorites as it pertains to Gators football. Favorite game, favorite season, favorite rivalry, favorite play, favorite player, favorite uniform combo. The last one isn't a favorite, but a most disappointing loss. So I figured we could change it up just a little bit for this episode.
Hey, man, sounds good. It's good to maybe get away from some of the more controversial stuff. Talk about all the stuff we've got in common as Gator fans, because we all started somewhere, and we all we all love the school and we all want to see him do well. So it's always good to reminisce and look back. This was actually a harder exercise than I thought it was going to be, trying to narrow it down. I'm like, well, you know, maybe I need like six honorable mention categories in each of these things just to talk about it. And, you know, I have different reasons for different things. And so, you know, some of them might be a little bit different than people would expect, but that's what makes it fun.
Absolutely. So we'll start with the favorite game part of this. And this one I picked because of two reasons. It was sentimental, and the result was one of the best in Gators history. So it's the 2008 National Championship game versus Oklahoma, my top pick. Of course, the season was great. And I was in the media room for Tebow's speech after the loss to Ole Miss. Then the Gators went on a tear the rest of the season and beat an undefeated Alabama in the SEC Championship without Percy Harvin, only to see him return in the title game and be that difference maker, even at not 100%. And that game was set up as this unstoppable Oklahoma offense, averaging over 40 points a game. And you knew as soon as Major Wright laid that hit on the sideline that the Gators defense was going to be there to make a point. And Oklahoma had their chances, and the Gators defense held on the goal line a couple times with some stands, and Ahmad Black making an incredible interception of Sam Bradford. But the Gators weren't going to be denied that night in Miami. We got another Tebow jump pass that sealed the game, and Gator Nation gets to celebrate the third national championship and a second in 3 years. But you know, it was most special because I got the experience with my dad. He had gotten laid off due to the economic downturn, and, you know, kind of bummed about that. He got to watch a lot of football that season. So, you know, my dad doesn't really like going to games a whole lot. Not a big crowd person. He'd rather crack a beer and sit at home and watch college football all day long. But we promised ourselves that if Florida ever made it to Miami to play for the national championship, that we were going to go together. So for Christmas that year, my mom and I surprised my dad with tickets to the game, and we were on our way to Miami to watch Florida play for a national championship. So, you know, we got to experience that together. Still a moment he talks about all the time to this day. You know, it was an escape for him after losing a job and just a great time between father and son. So that's why that 2008 national championship game is my favorite. It hit every aspect of being a fan.
Well, it's funny because it is those memories with your family that end up probably being the things that sort of indelible in your mind. But I go down every year to see a game with my dad and my brother, and have recently started taking my kids to see it as well. And so really, if I was going to pinpoint my favorite game, it's a weird one. So it's 2015 versus FSU. Florida State beat Florida 29-2, but it was the first game I took my daughter to. And so we had sort of planned earlier in the year. That was McElwain's first year. I wasn't really expecting Florida to be very good. My daughter's birthday is right around then, so we went down to my parents for her birthday, and then we were like, oh, the game will be at like noon or 3:30, it'll be fine. And of course, she's 6 years old and it's 8:00 at night. So she was a trooper, though, man. We went there and she asked all the right questions about why Treon Harris couldn't throw a complete pass, and then the safety was in the end zone real close to where we were, and she was cheering and like slapping people's hands and, you know, all sorts of stuff. And, you know, my dad was there for it too. So that was a lot of fun. And it's just, you know, those are the types of things I think that really, I mean, it's why we take this stuff seriously, right? Is that it matters in the capacity of the familial connection. I mean, if you were going to say on the field, my favorite game is South Carolina in 2006. I mean, I remember exactly where I was. I was heading over to my grandmother's house for dinner. I was living in Blacksburg at the time, going to Virginia Tech. And so Tech was playing that day too. A bunch of families in town. They're going over to my grandmother's house, and I'm not leaving the house until that game's over. And my wife's like, let's go. And I'm like, nope. So I was standing behind the couch watching the entire game, you know, just thinking, oh, well, maybe they'll finally salt this one away. And then they don't. And so I wound up an hour late to the game, or hour late to my grandmother's house. And she's like, where were you? And asking me all sorts of questions. And my uncle's like, I understand. Like, he knew exactly where I had been and why I was late, and fully supported it. So, and those are sort of my two favorite ones. They all have a family component. I think most people probably have a family component when it comes to what their favorite game is. But those are mine.
Yeah, I'll throw another one in there too. You know, the season wasn't so great, but it was 2002 versus Georgia. And it was giving them their only loss of the season. And as many of you know, I grew up in Georgia. all my best friends are Georgia fans. You know, we're going to that game. Ron's Luke's first year, the year after Steve Spurrier retired. You know, Florida didn't have a chance. I think Georgia was ranked in the top three, maybe top two at that point. You know, Bulldog fans were, you know, were excited. This is going to be the year they finally beat Florida. They're going to go on and win the national championship game. Me and a horde of Bulldog fans all rode down together. We get there early in the morning with game day being there. The game, it was the last time the game was played at night as well. And I remember the game being on ESPN in Florida in the white jerseys and the orange pants. And I believe we screen passed them to death the whole game. And they couldn't stop it. And Florida goes on to upset Georgia. And all my Georgia fans, it was the best ride back from Jacksonville ever, because I'm with about five or six Georgia fans. I'm the only Gator fan in the vehicle and with the biggest smile on my face. I didn't have to say a word. And that's all it was. I didn't have to say a word.
You did, though, right?
No.
You did say a word, right?
No, I didn't.
Oh,
I didn't.
Come on, Dave.
I had, you know, when you leave the stadium and you can buy those scorecards that have the score on it, I made sure that was seen the whole time with just a smiling face. I think that's what ticked them off the most. They wanted me to say something. They expected me to say something, and I never did.
You got to give them, like, the Archer, woo! Something like that, man. As long as we're talking about Georgia, I mean, was it 2008 where Urban Meyer called all the timeouts at the end? That one was pretty fun, too. So, yeah. There's always a good Georgia one in there, too.
That's true. There can never be too many Georgia ones, but that 2002, like I said, but 2008 is kind of along that same line. You know, they were preseason number one, and Florida ends up winning the national championship that year. So. we'll move on to the next one and favorite season, Will. And I went with the 2006 national championship season, mainly because, you know, on the surface, if you go back, it looked like Florida was not expected to do much that year, but they were ranked in the, you know, top 10 for most polls there. And Sporting News, I believe, had them very, very high, I believe top two, I believe, in their preseason magazine or whatever. But it was, you know, an average offense and a great defense. And the offense kind of, you know, got better, found the groove later on in the season, especially in the SEC championship game and the national championship. It was the emergence of Tim Tebow and Percy Harvin. Wasn't supposed to have a chance versus Ohio State and then go to Glendale and blow them out. And that season as a whole, you know, it was my first year at Channel 4. I graduated college in June, started there in June. And there I am on the sideline come September shooting every game for Florida for the TV station I worked for. And I was in pure heaven there getting to go to Gainesville and on the road for a few games and shooting Florida football when this historic season was happening. So, you know, 10 years after the first national championship, it was the 100-year anniversary of the University of Florida football as well. You know, everything just came together that year. So I think, all in all, personally and in my career, getting to cover Florida for the first time, and, you know, not really expecting to do much, but end up winning it all when it was all said and done.
Yeah, mine's 2012. That was that year where Will Muschamp's good year, where, you know, they came in ranked sort of 22nd, 23rd. People weren't expecting a whole lot. And then they had that gauntlet early where they went to Texas A&M before we knew that Johnny Manziel was Johnny Manziel. And he just lit it up in the first half.
Yeah.
And I was sitting there going, uh-oh, the defense is really going to be bad this year. But then they pulled it off late. They shut him down in the second half. We're really the only team to shut down Manziel the entire year, Alabama included. And then they went on the road at Tennessee and beat Tennessee in Knoxville pretty soundly as well. And then just laid the wood on number four LSU. I mean, they just handed it to Gillislee, it seemed like, the whole game. That was the game where it was like, okay, this is a real team that has a real chance. Yep. And, you know, from then on, the games were just entertaining the whole way through the year. You looked at, I mean, LSU was 14-6. Then there was that game against South Carolina where there were all sorts of turnovers, and it was 44-11 turnovers on punts and all sorts of different stuff.
And that was the week before Georgia.
Yeah, the game against Georgia, which obviously was disappointing, but was still entertaining. I mean, it was a killer, but it was entertaining. And then, again, they just laid it on Florida State at Doak. I mean, you know, you look at the degree of difficulty for that schedule. I mean, they're at Texas A&M, at Tennessee. Then they had LSU at home, South Carolina at home, neutral for Georgia, and at Florida State. I mean, that was a pretty decent gauntlet to go 4-1 against, and then almost made it to the national championship. Mm-hmm. We had Notre Dame playing USC. USC down on the goal line can't punch it in from the one. Otherwise, Florida's playing for the national championship. And I said 2012 because the Sugar Bowl against Louisville was played in 2013. So I'm going to ignore that game happened. But I mean, I'll be honest, whenever there are low expectations or when there are lower expectations and the team makes a championship run, I find those much more enjoyable than a season like 2008 or even 2009, where everybody expects them to be excellent. And then you're nitpicking, oh, they only won 44-7. What's wrong? It should have been 56 and those sorts of things. And you know, I'm critical of things all the time too, so I probably would have been one of those people at the time too. But all I remember is that 2008 and 2009 seemed a little bit more like a slog. 2012 was like, hey, we're back, and that was a lot of fun. And sort of the same feeling with McElwain in 2015 in that Ole Miss game. And I wonder how much fun that would have been had Greer not been suspended, just because it was the same general feeling where you weren't necessarily expecting the team to come out of the chute 6-0, and when they did, it was an awful lot of fun.
Yeah, 2012 season, you're right. That was a really fun season. And it was also just guys making big plays. You know, it always seemed like the offense found its way in like midway through the third quarter, fourth quarter, because they really just beat you up all game long. And like you said, Mike Gillisley, Matt Jones made his kind of presence known toward the end of the season. Yeah, you're right. You know, that team found ways to win. And I won't ever forget those back-to-back games with A&M and Tennessee. Jeff Driscoll was throwing the ball all over the yard in the second half of those games, making plays that needed to be made. And you're right. And then going to Doak and winning that game, and really just, you know, second half of that game, just laying it on them. I remember the Antonio Morrison hit on EJ Manuel, and, you know, getting excited. But only to follow up 2013 with a 4-win season. You know, we couldn't build off of that, unfortunately. But yeah, that 2012 season was a whole lot of fun.
Yeah, and I was a little bit young when the Spurrier years were going on.
Yeah, same here.
And so, you know, those don't stick out of my mind as much as some of the more recent ones do. But I will say that 2001 team with Rex Grossman that lost late at Auburn and then lost to Tennessee in the September 11th game that was moved towards the end of the year, and sort of having September 11th built in to the season and all the uniqueness that came with that, obviously a horrible thing, but still it made it. It was a really interesting season because Tennessee was late. That was a fantastic game, 32-34, back and forth the entire time. And quite honestly, I think Florida probably wins the national championship if they win that game. That was a heck of a team. Again, one of those teams that was really fun to watch. I mean, Grossman just lighting it up all over the place. If they win that Tennessee game, probably wins the Heisman Trophy. And then Spurrier's last stand. I mean, that was one of those things where it was like really the end of an era at Florida. And obviously, the earlier part of that era was something I was aware of, but not necessarily following near as closely as I was in 2001 or 2002. And you know, we obviously had quite a bit of success under Urban Meyer, but there have been some dry periods before and after him. And Spurrier really was, I think that 2001 season stuck out to me as sort of both an interesting thing from the way the team played, but also that was maybe the first time that people started thinking about the intensity that it is to be the coach of the Florida Gators. And that's certainly something that hasn't stopped now.
Yeah, absolutely right there. That 2001 season, I mean, I'll kind of hit on that too later on in some things. But that was a fun season as well. Well, let's go first with this next one, your favorite rivalry.
My favorite rivalry has changed. It's been Florida State for a really, really long time. I worked in Tallahassee for a year, so I had to deal with all those people for a year. But it's really kind of switched to LSU over the last few years, just in terms of the one that I really want to get. And part of that is that Florida State has been bad when Florida's been good, and Florida's been good when Florida State's been bad. And the other part is that Florida and LSU have just had some really, really unique games. So 2006, you had Jamarcus Russell, the jump pass, the quarterback play action that I'd never seen before to a wide open Lewis Murphy. In 2010, the fake 50-plus yard field goal where the guy threw it behind his head and it bounced on the ground. And I was at that game. I was actually at the jump pass game too. Bounced on the ground, picked up by the kicker, and then they turned that into a touchdown later in the game to win. 2011, Brad Wing had the fake punt touchdown touchdown, the penalty afterwards. 2014, Driscoll had a long pass to DeMarcus Robinson. They couldn't punch it in for a touchdown. The defense got a stop, and there was just a back-breaking interception from Driscoll to allow LSU to kick a field goal. They had the fake field goal for the game-winning touchdown after a deep throw to Callaway to tie the game.
And we were all sitting there saying, watch for it. The fans knew it. The fans knew it. But the coaches seem not to know it.
But yeah, the vast majority of these games I've been to, which also makes a difference. Like I said, I can only get down once a year. A lot of times the LSU game is like the best game on the schedule. It's not around a holiday. Yeah. And so I'm there a lot for that, and that kind of colors this. And then the last one is the Hurricane. Right, the Hurricane, where LSU act like a bunch of pansies, forcing you have to come to Baton Rouge because they couldn't allow their economy to be hurt by the Hurricane. Not as if Florida's economy didn't have some of the same things that were going on, but anyway, that whole thing and just the AD for LSU and sort of how he handled things and the fans and just the back and forth and all that sort of stuff, to me, ramped it up even more than it was. It was kind of a friendly rivalry before that. It's an unfriendly rivalry now. And to be honest, I kind of enjoy that. So,
I got some severe dislike for LSU after that. And then to go there and had that goal line stand the very last play of the game, that was – You know, it's funny, we're going to have favorite plays in this too, but for whatever reason, I forgot that play, and the goal line stand probably should be up there.
Well, and Voshon Joseph's hit on the quarterback.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, that's the thing is if you go back and really tick off plays in the LSU-Florida rivalry, like the game is always 24-21.
Yeah.
Or 27-24. It's always like that. So last year's 17-16. Is no surprise. In fact, there wasn't anything really special in last year's game that made me sit there and think, oh, that's one to cite. But again, they're always 17-16, 24-21. I don't really remember a whole lot. The only one is the Brad Wing fake field goal. That was one where Florida got absolutely trounced. But beyond that, I don't remember a lot of games where it's been out of hand one way or the other. I know Tebow's first game as a starter in 2007, where he threw the ball off of Harvin's hands. That one was a pretty decent beatdown by Florida.
That was 2008. 2007 is when at LSU and they had all those fourth down conversions.
Yeah, and then we had the concussion game. So that was during my brother's wedding. So
2009.
That was during my brother's wedding. So we were tasked with going out into the lobby and figuring out what the score was and reporting back to him to make sure that he could stay at the wedding and not cause problems. But I mean, like I said, there's a unique story with every one of those games. And so for me, that's always the thing. If Florida wins that LSU game, they're usually 4-2, 5-1, 6-0. Is the way they start the year. And it's really sort of a bellwether for how the season's going to go. By the time you get to Florida State, you kind of know how the season's gone. It obviously is important for recruiting, but LSU to me is sort of it's the point where you know what do you have from a team perspective.
Yeah, you read my mind about that. You know, a win versus LSU usually speaks to a pretty good season. That is definitely sure there. Kind of probably gave it away earlier, but me growing up in Georgia and all that kind of stuff, my favorite rivalry is the Georgia game, of course. You know, being in Jacksonville, I was born and raised in Jacksonville. Moved away to Georgia, for most of my school years there. So, you know, the game being, you know, in my hometown where I live at now, being raised in Georgia, all my best friends being Georgia fans, you know, that game speaks most to me than any other, just because of the connection to so many things there. I love the game being in Jacksonville. I don't ever want it to go home and home. I want the game in Jacksonville always. But it is, you know, kind of, you don't necessarily think of it. In the 90s, you had all those historic Florida State games. And as you mentioned lately, the Florida LSU rivalry. You've had Florida Tennessee games that have been knockdown dragouts. But for me, just because of the connection, and my dad being an older Gator fan, you know, hated Georgia growing up, you know, could never beat Georgia. So that kind of bled over to me as well. So being able to go to school when Spurrier's head coach and always winning winning but all but one of them. Urban Meyer, as you mentioned, calling the timeouts, running up the score. Even going the other way, you know, the Georgia, you know, on the Georgia side and the Marino touchdown and the team rushing onto the field, you know, it's still moments like that that make that game. But it is special that last weekend in October, usually always around Halloween, here in Jacksonville, that game, you know, just really speaks to me. It's kind of like a reunion for me of sorts. Get to see Georgia friends that come down for the game as well. So, and plus just the atmosphere of Jacksonville that weekend is unmatched. One of college football's best rivalries, just because of, you know, the uniqueness of it, and, you know, being split 50-50 in the stadium and being a neutral site rivalry. There's just so many things around that game. As I said, you know, there haven't, you know, you saw Run Lindsey Run, of course, in the early 80s on the Georgia side. And as I mentioned, 2002, Florida beating Georgia, giving their only loss, so a game they shouldn't have won there. The really rainy game in the early 90s, and Eric Rett running over Georgia like crazy with mud flowing everywhere before the stadium's getting torn down, and they have to go for 2 years playing in Athens and in Gainesville. And of course, can't forget Spurrier hanging half a hundred between the hedges there. So, you know, there are moments, and like I said, the game doesn't really have as many moments recently as Florida, Tennessee, and Florida, LSU, Florida, Florida State, but historically and personally, the connections for me, that's why Florida, Georgia's up there.
Well, we've always got the Treon Harris, what was it, 3 or 4 pass game?
Oh, Kelvin Taylor and Matt Jones running wild. I think they're still running.
Hey, man, it was a strategy that won the game. So yeah. Keep doing it till they can stop it.
Yeah, and they could not. And then Treon Harris beat them again to get Mark Rake fired, pretty much. So.
Well, maybe that was a bad thing.
Yeah. Darn you, Treon Harris. All right, well, we'll move on to favorite play. And you've kind of mentioned this one already, but I will go the blocked field goal versus South Carolina 2006. I was there, and I kind of mentioned this the other day. Something was posted on Facebook the other day, and I kind of retweeted it because it was something about this game. And I shared that, you know, I was on the sideline with a camera, but I was actually working for CSS, the old Comcast sports station here. I was running camera for them that game, and I was basically 5 feet from Steve Spurrier. The last play of the game, the field goal is getting lined up and getting ready to get kicked. You know, my task was, you know, the director was in my ear. All right, your camera's on Steve Spurrier. So I'm 5 feet from Steve Spurrier with a camera, you know, almost in his face. And all he could do was just grin and shake his head. Everybody knows that Steve Spurrier grin, man. Once it got blocked and the crowd went nuts, blocked by Jarvis Moss there, Spurrier could just give that signature grin, shake his head, and then just kind of jog out to midfield there. But, you know, being that close to Spurrier in that environment, the play in and of itself, you know, probably one of the loudest moments in the Swamp. Nobody will ever forget it. If you were watching Florida football around that time, it led Florida, helped propel them to another national championship. But, you know, that play right there really, really, really sticks out as my top play.
Yeah, so my favorite would be the Earl Everett tackle in the national championship game with no helmet. I think that sort of personifies that team, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, that was a team that just absolutely had an unbelievable defense. A lot of Ron Zook's guys, a lot of guys who were sort of mismatched parts for what Urban Meyer wanted to do, particularly on offense. But, man, did they give a ton of effort. And by the time you got to the end of the year, they were a really good – really, really good team. And we're, quite frankly, we're pretty disrespected going into that game against Ohio State, and had the initial kickoff return for a touchdown. And you know, all the people I knew from Ohio State were already gloating. And then it turned around pretty quickly.
Florida went right down right after that, marched right down the field.
Right to Dallas Baker. So yep. It really helps me now because the pastor of my church is a huge Ohio State fan. So, so I can give him crap for both the football game and the basketball game right after that. So that's probably my favorite. And second favorite would be Callaway from Greer on the fourth down. Mm-hmm. If for no other reason, because that was in the era of being able to put GIFs on Twitter. And so anytime a Tennessee fan gives you any sort of crap, you just post the Callaway fourth of forever. And Franks gave us another moment last year, so now you don't even know which one to post.
Yeah.
When they give you crap. And it's good that we have those two, because it was in between the one that Tennessee had that they were posting all last year. So you know, just because I said LSU was my favorite rivalry doesn't mean I don't hate all the other teams and suffer. And so, so that one's good for that.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned those two. You know, I had to. This was kind of easy to kind of quickly go through, but another one: Brandon Spikes hit on Knowshon Moreno in 2008. Early in that game, it really, you know, just set the tone when, you know, Brandon Spikes hits him behind the line of scrimmage, stays on top of him, says a few choice words, and I'm sure he was telling him how much he liked him and all that good stuff. But yeah, that hit, you know, just kind of, I think he just kind of knew right at that moment, okay, this is about to be a bubble.
Well, this one gets lost, but the fake punt in the SEC championship game against Arkansas in 2006. From you know, Urban Meyer, the offense was struggling. They were sputtering. And they were either just slightly ahead or a little bit behind. The momentum was in Arkansas's favor, and he called a fake punt from his own side of the field. And I'll be honest, I'm not sure either of the last two coaches would have called a fake punt in their own territory. And so I think that's been lost in sort of, because it wasn't the national championship, there was still another game to play. Yeah. Obviously, I think at the time people thought Florida was going to struggle with Ohio State, and then they came out and just blitzed Ohio State, and then that's sort of the memory along with the South Carolina block kicks. But that's one that does stick out when I think back about that season, is the fake punt against Arkansas.
All right, well, who's your favorite player?
Ernest Graham. So, so running back from 99 to 2003. This one, again, is more of a personal thing. So I played baseball against Ernest when he was – so I was living down in Fort Myers at the time and played baseball for Fort Myers High School and played against him when he was at Mariner. And I ripped one into the gap and thought it was going to be a double, and not even close. He caught it without barely even moving. And it was like, oh, that's what a real athlete that's what a real athlete looks like when they're out in the center field. So he was somebody, you know, played against him in high school, same age. We both went to Florida at the same time and sort of followed him through those years while he was there. First couple of years was Spurrier, and the next couple of years was Zook. You know, the teams were good but not great in that span, though obviously we already talked about the 2001 team and how good they were. But it's interesting that when you have a personal connection to the player, you just sort of gravitate towards rooting for him and pulling for him regardless of what the production is. And Ernest had pretty good production. I mean, over 3,000 yards while he was at Florida, went on to the Tampa Bay Buccaneers and really successful career there as well. But anyway, yeah, he's my favorite. And, you know, most people, I think, say Tebow or something like, or Percy Harvin or something like that. And for me, it's just, you know, I saw him in high school before anybody knew about him. And then he went to Florida and I was there too. And so it just made it really easy for me to latch on to him.
Got you there. Yeah, I had a hard time choosing between Rex Grossman and Percy Harvin there. You know, Grossman, you go back and look at it's just that 2001 season. And if it would have ended up with a national championship, and the Heisman probably would definitely have been looked at even more. But he couldn't have done much more than what he did in that 2001 season. And kind of a shame, too, that he had to be the quarterback making the transition from Spurrier to Zook. You know, if Spurrier would have stuck around, Grossman still, you know, I mean, he put up good numbers under Zook, but you know, probably still would have been superb numbers given under Spurrier. You know, it just would have been a nice chance to see how he would have evolved from that 2001 season. And Caldwell and Gaffney wouldn't have been there the whole time with him as well. But, you know, he would have garnered more experience, still had that Spurrier system, which he really didn't – it didn't seem to matter who was that receiver so much. You know, Spurrier could just put whoever in there and still make something go. And for Percy Harvin, you know, just – kind of just self-explanatory. You go back and watch, and you know, you did, every time he touched the ball, you were just waiting for something to happen. You know, a big play here, a big play there, whether it be a run out of the backfield or a screen pass that he'd take or a pass deep down the field. You know, Percy Harvin could do it all. You know, and probably, you know, but besides Reggie Bush, was just kind of one of those, because they were around the same time, and just watching both of those guys. You know, just the electricity of every time they touched the ball. You never knew what was coming, except, you know, a big play and just using speed to get out there. He had some, you know, plays where he would juke and make somebody lose their socks, but it was mostly just that speed from the time he touched the ball, 0 to 100. And that's what Percy Harvin was.
Yeah, I mean, those guys are great. I remember you know, Reggie Nelson being somebody else who was just electric on those teams, the eraser, and watching him play at safety and just seeing the way he could change a game from the defensive side. And Florida's had a lot of those guys. I mean, you know, you look at Keanu Neal, you look at Marcel Harris, those sorts of guys, and sort of a tradition at Florida. I mean, people say DBU, and I think they immediately think Jalen Tabor, Quincy Wilson, Joe Hayden, guys like that. But I think that also has to include the safeties that have come through. They've been very, very good.
Yeah, Ahmad Black, Major Wright, you know, we mentioned him earlier for that 2008 season. Yeah, safety as well has been part of that DBU moniker for sure. So a couple more here, Will, kind of the easier ones here. Favorite uniform combination?
It's going to get you in trouble, Dave.
It probably is. It is because, of course, I'm going white helmet. And if you're watching the YouTube version, people can see it behind me, of course. But the white helmet and the slanted F. I don't care if you don't like the slanted F. It's my logo. And shout out to Chris out there, where because I know it's his too. We've been talking about it. But the white helmet and the slanted F. Ever since they broke them out in 2009, it was, you know, against FSU. Then they wore them again the next week versus Alabama in the SEC championship game. And not so many great moments there. Not so many great moments in those helmets to begin with. But honestly, a uniform does not make a team win or lose. Get over that, people. But I really like the all white that they broke out against Tennessee a couple years ago. Another loss, of course. But the white helmet, the white jersey, the white pants is probably my favorite look. But if we'll go classic, you know, if we go orange helmet, I would say the orange helmet and all blue. With blue jersey, blue pants, it would be my favorite traditional combo there. But favorite overall is the white helmet, and I go back and forth: blue jersey, white pants, or just the all white. But the white helmet has to be in there.
You're not providing a lot of evidence that these helmets aren't tied to wins and losses, there, Dave. I think every game you cited was a loss and a bad one at that.
But yeah, they started off so good against FSU in 2009, but yeah, ever since then, I mean, I'll admit they don't do it. They don't do it for them. But sorry, they could go and right before those games and switch back to orange. It ain't gonna matter.
I'll say I'm not a huge fan of the F. But I like the white helmets. If you told me I had to pick one uniform combination that they've worn thus far over the last 10 or 20 years, I'd say the old school white helmet with the blue top with the orange stripes on the sleeves and then the white pants. I love that old school look that, you know, they used to wear when Spurrier was around, and they brought that back for a few games during that era with Urban Meyer, and I loved it when they had that. You know, again, if you're going to go white helmet, I like if it's balanced. So either go with the Gator script or go with the F. Well, Don't do one on either side.
They have that now, Will. They have that now.
And I do prefer the Gator script to the slanted F. And then, you know. And then I go blue. So blue jersey, blue pants,
okay.
White helmets would be the way I'd go on that. And then the only request I have is absolutely never wear the orange pants with the blue jersey ever again. It doesn't look right, and they lose when they wear it for the most part. And I know the uniform doesn't really actually do that, but again, that Louisville game is the one that sticks in my head with the orange pants, the blue jersey, and my dad going, "Well, that's it." The minute they ran out on the field, my dad wouldn't be on Twitter anyway. So back before the equipment team tweeted the uniforms on the day. But anyway, that would be my only request. Is I'm good with anything they wear, really. I think most of them look really sharp.
Yeah.
As long as it's not the orange pants with the blue jersey. That's not my cup of tea.
Yeah, those classic jerseys you're talking about in 06 when they wore against Bama. Yeah, and Reggie Nelson, as you mentioned, him had that big pick to kind of seal that game away. But yeah, there's a lot of people mention that as their favorite jerseys as well. And you had the white helmet with kind of the small block F there. Yeah, it was that was a sweet looking jersey too. I remember being down on the sideline, you know, filming there for that game as well, and just, you know, seeing that up close, I was like, man, they might need to make these some permanent jerseys, but they didn't.
They are sharp. So I actually had Sean Steed, who made the Read and React logo recently. That's part of the logo is sort of mimicking that, and it was just something I absolutely wanted to have. So definitely my favorite. It's the old school stuff.
Yeah. Hey, Mullen was there at that time. Maybe he hears how well received that jersey is. So he can.
Well, I hear black is coming. So
yeah, he has said black is coming.
No, I'm surprised you didn't say swamp green was your favorite there, Dave. I figured that'd be your that'd be your favorite. To be honest, I actually didn't mind those that much, except for that I couldn't tell who the players were because it was so hard to see the numbers. Yeah. And so going back and looking at the film, trying to figure out whether they targeted the correct players and all that sort of stuff took more time than it does when they wear their normal stuff. So
that's all I remember is a galloping Felipe Franks in those jerseys.
Well, all I know is hopefully if they go with something dark again, it'll be white letters and white numbers rather than orange.
Yeah. As far as talking about the all white, if they ever try to do something like that again, not a lot of the audience watches the softball team, but the softball team has those ice jerseys, I think, where the all white. They need to find a way to copy that for the football jerseys because those are some sharp looking unis.
Hey man, as long as they don't have the yellow flowers in their hair.
So. All right, Will, here we go. Time to get negative just for a second. Most disappointing loss. I'll let you go with that one.
So this one, there is zero competition for this one for me.
Okay.
It's the incomplete pass that was called a fumble against Auburn. That right at the end of that game, and at the time, I thought it cost us the national championship.
Yeah,
ESPN had Cowherd on some weird simulcast where he was talking through the game. He had been talking up Florida on his radio show all week long. It looked like Florida was turning into a juggernaut, and then they go on the road to Auburn, and it just felt like Florida got jobbed in that game. Like they had struggled the whole game. They drive down the field. You're never going to convince me that wasn't a forward pass from League. Like if you watch the replay, it goes forward from his hand and then hits the Auburn defender. How is that not a forward pass? I don't understand how that's a fumble. So, on the telecast when it happened, I thought it was an incomplete pass. Then they showed the replay and I thought it was an incomplete pass. Then they did the review and I'm like, oh, they're going to overturn this stuff. And then they kept it the way it was on the field. And I'm just like, oh.
Did they have a review back then? Oh, wait, it was
they did. They did review that play. I remember them reviewing it distinctly because I remember thinking, oh, there's no way someone would uphold that as a fumble. And it would have given us another shot because it wasn't like it was fourth down or anything. It was just, Leak came up from a play action fake, I think. And when he did, the defensive end was right there. It was a great defensive call, great play by the line, or I think by the defensive end. But he threw the ball away. Like it looked awkward, but it was a pass. And I will go to my grave contending that that was a pass. And it felt like, the ones where you get beat because you make your own mistakes to me are easier to swallow than the ones where you feel like the officials sort of took it from you. And so to me, that is the one that just sticks in my mind. And I mean, Florida even won the national championship that year. And I'm still sitting here going, we should have been undefeated. And at the time, it really felt like that was going to be a problem. And luckily on the road and all those sorts of things. But even at the end of the year, you had Ohio State and Michigan playing each other. And the question was, were you going to be able to jump them? Or was there going to be a rematch and all that sort of stuff? That was the one where it was just like, oh, I could not believe it.
My most disappointing loss, I'll go back to 2001. You mentioned earlier that Tennessee game. I distinctly remember it, as you said. It has been pushed back to the end of the year because of September 11th. A lot of people believe if they would have been played earlier, Florida would have won that game with the way they were rolling. But Tennessee got better as the year was going on and come to Gainesville in a highly, I think, a top five matchup. But Florida was favored by like 13, 15 points or something like that. And both teams were like within two rankings of each other. But I think Florida was third or second or something like that. And Tennessee was fourth or fifth, something like that. And Tennessee comes and Travis Stevens runs for over 200 yards. And, Florida still had a chance at the end. And a pass to Grossman to Gaffney, where I still think Gaffney was, I believe it was a 2-point conversion at that point they were going for. And I thought Gaffney was interfered with, by no means was the reason Florida lost that game. But that one, just because you knew if Florida won that game, they were going on to the SEC championship game. They were going to play an LSU team that they had already beat the Brits off of earlier in that year. Tennessee did end up losing the LSU, so you know, who knows? You know, Florida would have still had to come ready to play that game, but you probably would have set up a Florida-Miami national championship game in the Rose Bowl. Probably would have gave Rex Grossman a Heisman Trophy, as we mentioned. Now, I don't know if Florida would have beat that Miami team, but I sure as heck would have liked to have seen that matchup. The Miami team was really, really, really good. But you know, just to also say a Florida-Miami national championship game would have been so much fun and just a build-up in the state of Florida for that one.
Yeah, the only other one I'd mention in that sort of framework is the 2012 game against Georgia.
There you go. That's my other one as well.
Which I remember is the Jordan Reed game, which is probably unfair because there were so many mistakes in that game. I mean, I think there were 5 turnovers. Mm-hmm. It was just Florida dominated the game and lost because they couldn't hold on to the football. And again, that was one of those where it's tough to swallow because you feel like you're the better team. But at least in that capacity, the mistakes that were made were made by the players on the field, and that's the kind of thing that happens from time to time. But again, the things that were on the line, I mean, if they'd have beaten Georgia in that game, they're playing for the national championship. I mean, that's now they also would have been playing in the SEC championship game, and we'll see we would have seen what would have happened there. But they would have had an opportunity to play Alabama for the chance to go to the national championship, and that's all you can ask for. So again, when you start talking about the missed opportunities and things like that, and who knows how the Muschamp era changes if they go and play in that SEC championship game and give Alabama a game or even pull it out. I mean, at that point, you got a guy who's gone to the national championship, probably won it because Notre Dame was not that good that year, I don't think. And who knows how the story changes if that happens. That's a pretty good what if, that if they had happened to pull out that game. I mean, you know, is Will Muschamp still at Florida? Has he found his 18th offensive coordinator to coming off another 4-8 season?
But, yeah, I can't really add much more to that game than what you already said. But yeah, that one, that was the dagger.
Yeah, but again, that one was self-imposed. Yeah, I mean, that one was definitively the team had some issues, and for me, the harder ones are always the ones where you feel like the officials sort of decide it, and I'm sure Tennessee feels the same way about the game where who was it? Was it Caldwell who caught the ball in the end zone? It was stripped almost immediately.
Gaffney.
So I'm sure they feel the same way about that one. And
I'll say it was a catch because I'm a Gator fan, but it wasn't a catch.
Well, anyway, you know, those sorts of games are the ones that are harder to get over, at least for me. And so that'd be my most disappointing one.
All right. Well, some Gators Breakdown listeners also shared some of theirs, so I'll get to theirs. Brandon Sanders says, of course, it's Tebow. He's talking about his favorite player. But growing up in the 80s and 90s, my favorite players were Tommy Lomack and Shea Showers. Till Jack Jackson came along. Jack Jackson is my all-time favorite wide receiver. Favorite game would have to be the 97 Sugar Bowl. And, of course, that is giving Florida the first national championship game versus FSU. And there it is, Will. You know, that's what you and I kind of talked about. You know, it is funny neither one of us mentioned the first national championship game. But, you know, I was 13 at the time. So, of course, you know, of course I was watching and there. But as you said, the older you get, the more emotionally invested you get. So, you know, the Spurrier games, you know, I remember them. And I still remember cheering and all that. But, you know, not as basically when I become obsessed later on in my years.
Well, I came to Gator fandom a little bit later in life because I lived in Indiana for the first 16 years of my life. And then we moved down to South Florida. And really, you know, it wasn't like I had Florida or Florida State. I mean, I would probably, to be honest with you, was more partial to Florida State until I realized that I was going to get a better education at Florida. And so when it came down to choosing where I was going to go, it was pretty clear that I needed to go to Florida. And so at that point, that was where I was. But, you know, 18 years old, 1999, the Spurrier only had a couple of years left. And so that's – I completely understand if people would say we're being slanted towards the the more recent stuff. But that's because that's when I was a diehard.
Right. I mean, that's Ari just kind of speak to that a little bit. So that's what it is for the most part there. So Tag at Original Gator, it says two favorite moments. So here it is, 1996 National Championship game, the Ike Heriard stop and pop. It's kind of funny, you know, going back to that 96 game, the SEC Championship game that year against Alabama was my first Gator game ever. Like I said, my dad just didn't really like going to games all that much. But a friend of his had gotten sick and couldn't go to the SEC Championship game. He just gave my dad the tickets. You know, he said, take your son to the game. So, you know, went to Atlanta from South Georgia. So I had about the 4.5 hour drive. It was my first experience, you know, seeing the Gators in person, up in the nosebleeds of the Georgia Dome. But, you know, 13-year-old me was about the happiest I could be.
Hey, man, nosebleeds are great. I'll be honest. I sit up in the, like, what do they call them? Like the sunshine terrace or something. I love that place. I can see it. I can see all the holes open up and all the throws and all that sort of stuff. There is not a bad seat in the swamp. And, you know, I don't know how it is in Atlanta, but you know, I'm never going to complain about free.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that was it too. And then, of course, you know, 96, of course, it was revenge versus Florida State. Werfel was getting hit to the echo of the whistle, as FSU like to say it so much. You know, Florida got their revenge in their rematch, you know, after beating Alabama in the SEC championship game and then going to New Orleans and playing FSU again and blowing them out for their first national championship. And his second favorite moment for Tag says 2006 SEC championship game versus Arkansas. Percy going up the middle, absolutely blew by everyone on the field. Defining moment for Percy, the 2016 on its way to the national championship and for the Urban era. Sarasota Gator, 22. Favorite game, home, 1991. Florida 14, FSU 9. Passes broken up in the end zone by Bill Spear and Larry Kennedy. Away game, 2000, as we mentioned this, well, Florida, Tennessee, and they put in parentheses, Jabbar Gaffney catch.
Well, that's somebody who thinks Tennessee's the biggest rival. That's for sure.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, there we go. Player, it's an offense, Ben Troop. Defense, Javon Kearse. Favorite season, there's 2006. Favorite moment, the right hit and the Moss blocked field goal. So, you know, we kind of hit on those. Lord Heller says 97 versus FSU, Spurrier playing two quarterbacks. Quincy Green, Fred Taylor, upset number one team. Dashter hopes for Natty. Favorite player, it's just too many, but Emmett and Percy. They could score on any play. And beating FSU for the first Natty was one of their favorite moments. And, yeah, Will, I mean, going back in that 97 game as well, a lot of people will have that as their favorite game. It's kind of coined the loudest game in the swamp. And, of course, you know, Doug Johnson hits Quezzy down the sideline, and he runs for, you know, gets Florida in good field position where Fred Taylor then takes over. Florida takes the lead and upsets FSU and does ruin their national championship. You know, those – you know, 95, 96, the rematch for the Sugar Bowl, and then 97. You know, that little run of Florida State, that was a great run for Gator fans.
Yeah, well, we had Jaquez on the podcast last year to talk about that and sort of his memories of that. And so, you know, every time you watch it, you know, again, I wasn't a diehard at that point, but still, you go back and watch that stuff through the framework of being a diehard now, and it's awfully fun.
Can we get back to that? Come on. Well, that was some good stuff. And part of getting back to that, of course, and we'll quickly tackle your article here, is, you know, recruiting in your latest article. Recruiting is the hot button topic right now. And you tackle do on-field results matter in recruiting rankings?
Yeah, so I mean that's been sort of the hot topic on Gator Twitter, at least, especially after Chris Steele and some of the other guys who've been out of state recruits have decided to go elsewhere. And you know, it was always a high variance strategy for Mullen to have all of these out of state targets, and a lot of his elite recruits are the high level guys that he targeted are out of state. And you know, when you're going to do something like that, if you hit, hey, you look fantastic. If you don't, people start questioning your approach. And so, you know, the refrain from people in April and May, when we started bringing up, hey, Florida's a little bit behind, was, well, it's only April, it's only May. Well, now we're in July, and they're saying, you know, you're still hearing, well, it's only July, because National Signing Day is only till February. And so, you know, a couple of weeks ago, I came on and talked about blue chips and how it doesn't appear that success on the field increases the number of blue chips that you get. So you still get more throughout the season and after the season. But if you had, you know, 30% blue chips before the season, you have 30% after. It was a very limited sample size that I looked at. So this time I went back and I looked and I said, okay, let's look at everybody's recruiting class from 2017 to 2014, the second recruiting class for a new coach who came on. So you had Charlie Strong at Texas, you had Chris Peterson at Washington, Sarkisian at USC, James Franklin at Penn State, you know, Jim Harbaugh, Jim McElwain, you had Mark Richt, Kirby Smart, Justin Fuente. Look at all those guys and say, okay, who actually performed on the field? And out of that, you had the coaches who took from their predecessor and increased the number of wins. There was Fuente, Richt, McElwain, Harbaugh, Narduzzi, Muschamp at South Carolina, Clay Helton at USC, DJ Durkin at Maryland, Jeff Brohm, Tom Herman, Ed Orgeron, and then, you know, we'll see what happens with Dan Mullen. So you got 11 guys there that you can look at and say, okay, well, what did they do from a recruiting perspective? So I averaged all the recruits prior to August 1st and after August 1st and said, okay, they had some success during the season. Did that pay off in the recruiting rankings? And there was a little bit of a bump. So the average recruit ranking was 657th nationally. For those guys, there were 130 recruits prior to August 1st in these guys' second year bump class. There were 130 recruits after August 1st. So really August 1st is sort of that halfway point like we've talked about. So the average national rank before was 657. The average national rank after was 556. So there is about a 15% improvement for these coaches. But when I started looking at the guys who didn't improve records, I saw very similar things. So you look at Charlie Strong at Texas, they got worse, but his recruiting basically stayed the same. In fact, got a little bit better during the season and after August 1st. And if you look at Matt Rhule at Baylor last year, his recruiting got way better. It was less total recruits after August 1st, but 50% of them were blue chips, and his recruiting got better as well, even after they went 1-11. So, you know, there's mounting evidence, I think, that the 2018 performance on the field will not significantly impact the 2019 recruiting class. That doesn't mean Mullen's a bad coach. It doesn't mean that he's not going to do a fantastic job on the field. It just means that saying, hey, it's only July in a couple of weeks isn't going to be a valid excuse anymore. I mean, really, what we should expect historically is that on August 1st, Florida's class from a ratio perspective looks about like what it's going to look like in on National Signing Day. And that's okay. It's just that is what it is. And so at that point, we can start saying, okay, this is probably what we can expect going forward. Now, all that being said, Friday Night Lights is coming up. And Mullen could absolutely light it up. He could have seven blue chip guys commit. And when he does, his average recruit will go way, way up. But right now he's got 11 recruits and their national average is 497, which if you look at the 24/7 is an 87.9 recruiting ranking, which is really low historically for Florida. That's what it is. Now, again, if he brings in six blue chip guys after Friday Night Lights, that'll completely change that. It'll change the picture a little bit. But, you know, even right now, if he were to bring in 14 guys, the 150th recruit to the 163rd recruit, just that block of guys, you know, really, really high level blue chip guys. And that's all he brought in 14 more of those guys to fill out the class to 25. You're probably looking at a class that ends up around ninth. And so that's sort of the top end of what the recruiting class is going to look like this year, most likely, unless he brings in some really top-tier talent. If he brings in somebody ranked 20th, 30th, 40th, those guys tend to have a higher impact on the actual recruiting at 24/7, and for good reason. I think those guys turn out to be elite more often than guys in the hundreds and more often than guys in the 500s. So anyway, that's probably what we're looking at, is where the ceiling is probably somewhere around ninth, eighth or ninth, and probably the truth is, and the floor is probably around 18th or 19th, and the truth is probably somewhere in the middle. So we're looking at a 12th or a 13th ranked recruiting class. It's not the end of the world, but it is an issue when Florida State, Georgia, and even Miami are recruiting at a level that's higher than that. And that's something that the staff is going to have to look at, and Mullen's going to have to look at and say, hey, do we need to change our approach? Because the approach this year is something that I think a lot of fans, again, sometimes the results on the field, sometimes the results on the recruiting trail are not going to be what you want. The question is, was the approach right? And in this case, I think some people, including myself, are questioning the approach of focusing out of state as much as they have, which has sort of put them behind the ball on some of the Florida recruits as well.
Yep, so it'll be interesting, Will, how it all pans out. And what I want to say is, you know, when you bring data like this to the table, you know, it's not an indictment of Mullen if he will get it done or if he can't get it done. You know, these are just points that we can throw out there and say, hey, look, if he does overcome this, this is how hard it was actually to overcome it. There's a lot of data out there that shows a lot of people didn't do this. So if Mullen goes in and gets a top 10 class or around that, you know, he had to work his tail off because the data tells us that, you know, he had to. He would have had to get a top 10 class, you know, start nailing a lot of, you know, blue chips and getting them in the fold. So, you know, at least with the data out there, we can show if he can buck the trend or if he is bucking the trend, exactly how hard it was.
You're such an optimist, Dave. I love it. No, I agree. I mean, if Mullen goes out there with a class that's you know, essentially this year his average class is around 15. If he brings in one at 12, then next year he's going to be around 13. If he puts it up consistent top 10 seasons, that's going to be a very impressive feat. Not because the players that he has on the roster are bad, but because depth usually is where you suffer on a recruiting class. That, you know, the difference between a recruiting class at 3 and a recruiting class at 15 is usually depth. And we saw that last year with some of the suspensions. We saw that with some of the injuries. And by the time you got through the injuries and suspensions, God, by the time we got to the Georgia game, the team was kind of a skeleton of what we thought it would be going into the year. And it's not a coincidence that depth became an issue 3 years after Jim McElwain had a recruiting class ranked, I think, 21st in 2015 as his transition class. So, you know, Mullen had a very good transition class. It'll be interesting to see where this ends up. Like you said, I think if he can turn these into top 10 teams, it'll say something about his coaching ability, particularly if the quarterback play improves significantly. And the other thing is that it's to me, look, I want to find evidence that says that Mullen is going to succeed. I mean, that's the goal. But when the evidence says that historical precedent indicates that this is a problem, well, it's not me criticizing Mullen for the sake of criticizing him. It's pointing out that this, you know, just from an evidence perspective is concerning. And I think, you know, we need to take that into account. And I also think we need to take from both sides. I mean, you know, my point has been you have to wait until after Friday Night Lights. You have to wait until August 1st. But at that point, I think you can start making some generalizations, and you can't just say, oh, it's only August. Like, I don't think that flies. You can say it, but there's no real evidence that indicates that you're right. And so, you know, again, I'm searching for it. I would love it if guys who had lots of success on the field all of a sudden were just reeling in blue chips, but that's just not something that's happened. It indicates, you know, we talked a lot about accuracy and how accuracy seems to translate pretty well from high school to college. And I think when we look at recruiting, at least in the bump class, we can say recruiting is something that's, you know, it's not an on-field thing for 2019, at least for Mullen. You know, you look at Kirby Smart, immediately his classes were good in that second year. You look at Tom Herman, immediately his classes were good in the second year. Saban's the same way. Urban Meyer's the same way. And people will say Dabo Swinney, but I don't want to be relying on outliers. No. At $6 million a year. Like, you know, you want to be able to play with those big boys because they're in the conference. But again, like I said, like you said, if Mullen can have top 10 teams with the guys he's got right now, it's an excellent job. And the recruits are going to come in 2020 and 2021 because of what's on the field. There is a correlation there. I haven't had a chance to really dig into it. And quite honestly, probably won't till next year, but
well, I've teased it, and I think Bill Sykes might have something about that. Sorry.
We're
show coming up soon.
We're getting somebody back, man. Everybody's gonna be excited to not have to listen to me anymore. So, or at least have give me the pump and the brakes.
So what's gonna happen? I'll intro. You say one word, and we just let Bill go.
Well, how's it any different from when he used to come on, man?
I'm gonna record that and send it to him.
Well, he sent me an email after he read my article the other day. It said it's only July, so right back at him, man. Right back at him.
You know he's picking on you about that.
Oh man, no, we love Bill. It'll be great to have him back, and certainly everybody's sort of been entertained. They want to hear from him. I mean, this is sort of his cup of tea, so interested to hear what he has to say, and it'll be fun to have him back.
All right, Will, you mentioned Friday Night Lights and what can happen there. A few names that are going to be there, of course. Kayvon Thibodeau, number one recruit in the nation, says he'll be there. Nathan Pickering, even though committed to Mississippi State, will be visiting as well. DeJuan Black, big-time star there. Commit Jalen Jones, of course, says I messaged him the other day. We had him on the podcast a couple weeks ago, confirmed to me that he will be our Friday Night Lights. So good to have your four-star quarterback on campus, you know, being able to talk to different recruits and help recruit as well, him being here. Kyrie Elam, big-time target. of course, here, Lloyd Summerall, a big target. A lot of people think leaning towards Florida will be at Friday Night Lights as well. Jalen Humphreys, commit, will be here. Tyron Hopper, commit, also will be Friday Night Lights. And, of course, Josiah Pierre, recently committed, as well as Jamal Abrams. Just a few names that have confirmed, more out there as well. But, you know, just the guys of note that will be at Friday Night Lights.
Oh, man, I'm looking forward to it. And hopefully we got some commits to talk about after that.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. All right, Will, we did it again. Anything else out there? You messaged me. You had some kind of an outline of what you could be working on with Read and Reaction coming up soon.
Yeah, so I'm going to be doing some best case, worst case type of things. So looking at each one of the teams on Florida's schedule in the East, and then probably LSU as well, and looking at what could break right, what could break wrong in their seasons, and then sort of how they compare to Florida within that framework. So recruiting rankings, and it'll dovetail pretty nicely, I think, with some of the previews we're going to be doing. But anyway, I'm looking forward to talking about worst case scenario for Georgia being Fromm's broken hand causing a quarterback controversy. And you know, somebody punching Kirby in the locker room. That's probably the worst case. The worst case for Georgia. But you know, it is interesting. I mean, I got my
ski mask ready to go.
Well, it's interesting because everything went right for Georgia last year, right? I mean, you get Eason knocked out. Fromm comes in. All of a sudden, he's unbelievable. They're able to sort of limp their way through that Notre Dame game on the road. And at that point, it was sort of, you know, I mean, Florida obviously struggled last year and was not exactly the formidable opponent they normally are for Georgia. And you know, and then they didn't have to play Alabama in the SEC championship game. You know, everything broke right until that last play. And, you know, if that's a harbinger for how things are going to go for them in 2018, then that worst case scenario part will be interesting to write.
Absolutely. Remember, you can find Will on Twitter at WillMilesSEC and his site, readandreaction.com. I'm your host of Gators Breakdown, David Waters. You can find me on Twitter at GatorDave_SEC. Guys and girls out there, thanks for listening to this episode of Gators Breakdown.